our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. Are you church? Need your power in us. Seek your kingdom first. Hunger every thirst. Refuse to waste our lives. For our joy and pride. To see the captive hearts released. The hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are a church, and we pray, revive this earth. Build your kingdom here, let the darkness flee. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and lands. Set your church on.
To join us on Mother's Day. Welcome all of you ladies and women of influence. We're glad that you're here with us today. So my name is Jen, and I am part of our announcement team, and I have the privilege and honor of sharing the stage this morning.
Hi, my name is Kylie, and that's my mom.
Isn't that awesome? I get to share the stage with my daughter on Mother's Day. What could be more perfect than that? I would also like to say hi, live stream. We're glad that you're here with us as well. Any of you mothers and women of influence, we're glad that you have been able to join us this morning. And also, my little daughter, Lacey, who's usually part of the Joyful Noise, is not feeling well, and I told her I'd give her a little hi. So, hi, Lacey. Hope you feel better this morning, sweetie. So, summer is coming and Foothills is not slowing down. We have a lot going on this summer. So, Kylie, what are some of the things that you're looking forward to this summer?
Swimming, going to the river, camping, less school, and sleeping in.
Ha, less school. She's homeschooled, so there'll be a little bit. So we encourage you to stay connected here at Foothills because we do have a lot of things going on and we are not taking a break. So what activities from FSM are you looking forward to?
The Malala River Meetup. I did that one last year and it was really fun. And the small groups to get together. That was fun too.
So FSM is our Foothills Student Ministry, and they are also going to be meeting throughout the summer, both our middle school and our high school. Kurt and Kristen have events planned for them throughout the summer, so you'll be just stay tuned of what those are going to be and when. Also, our kids' church is not going to stop either. Joanne, our kids' church director, is planning a VBS. And here at Foothills, that is going to mean very best summer. And this is for elementary age kids. Again, more information coming soon. Also, as you walked in the door, you got our happenings flyer. This happenings flyer is a great way to stay up to date with all of these summer things that are coming as dates and times come out and event locations. You can find all of that there. We are going to have things like church in the park with a picnic and a baptism here at the Malala River. There's also tons of volunteer opportunities that you can find in that happenings flyer. And we love that our youth can serve here in this church. And as you can see, we have Kylie, and she is a volunteer. Kylie, where do you volunteer and where do you serve?
I work at the cookie table, and I like about it that I can greet our guests, serve cookies, of course, and see people I know and meet new ones as well. And I like that Tammy trusts me to work at the table.
So this church has done a really great job about coming beside our youth and finding ways that they can serve and belong and be a part of Foothills, and we love that. So Tammy is a part of that, and she is looking to join to get a team going for Communion Sundays. She needs a team to help prep and clean up during those Communion Sundays. So if this is a way that you think that you can serve with your family, this would be a great opportunity to jump right into that, and you can contact Tammy if you need more information. Next, we have a new message series coming up, and that is going to start this next week. It is a full summer series, and it is called Making Our Faith Work. This is going to be going through the book of James, and our various pastors here are going to lead us through the summer, and so we would invite you to come back every Sunday to kind of see what they have to tell us about learning what genuine faith looks like. Also, as you arrived, you got your blue cards. Again, we love those blue cards. That's a way that we can stay in community with you, and we can stay connected with you through the summer as well. So if you have any praises or prayer requests, we would invite you to fill those out and turn them into the back. So, Kylie, you wrote up something about a woman of influence in your life. Could you read that for us?
Rachel is someone important to me. She listens to me when I need to talk and gives me love when I am sad. While my parents were out of town, Rachel was the first person I wanted to be with. She is more than my mom's best friend. She's like a second mom to me. I love you, Rachel, your family.
I do love you. Thank you. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to go into more worship. Father, thank you so much for giving us the women of influence in our lives. We pray that they would feel honored today as we look at biblical women of influence. We pray that you would grant generational changes and blessings to this church. We love you. Amen.
Because she makes me watch.
Because mom loves to play Wiggles with me.
She loves to play Wiggles?
No, Legos.
Legos.
Yeah.
Do you love anything else about her?
Yep. And mommy loves Granny and me.
Because she takes me to drop my brother off at school.
And do you love her for any other reason?
Yeah.
What else?
And she takes me to the store and she gets some great groceries because she does everything I like her to do. and she plays Barbies with me sometimes. And she chooses the clothes for me. And I like it when she makes me kind of a little bit of food that I know how to make sometimes.
Yeah. So, can it be me and Mom are going to be a firefighter?
Because she always reads me stories. Because summertime she gives us happy meals every Sunday.
Because I just really love her.
Because she loves me.
I just love her.
I love my mom.
I love my mommy. And she lets us go on adventures and she's warm.
Because she gives me ice cream every night.
Worshiping.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? Cause shame's done all it's stealing. And you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus.
Did they do a great job or what? Let's thank it one more time. Woo! Well done. Well done. Love having the kids up here. So, good morning. Yeah, I'm in a suit. You're not mistaken. Well, for those of you that don't know the tradition here, this is the Mother's Day outfit, the Mother's Day suit. And the uniform I wear once a year, you just wait till Father's Day. It'll change, all right? Yes. Welcome those that are watching on the live stream. Thanks for joining us on Mother's Day. And what a great day it is. So today we are going to celebrate the influence of women. Even though it's Mother's Day, you don't have to be a mother to have influence. Most of us have had some very influential women leave a lasting impact on our life over the years. And today we celebrate and we acknowledge this fact. I also realize that Mother's Day is a very difficult day for some. Therefore, as we celebrate Mother's Day, again, we are celebrating the influence that God has given and entrusted to all women today. So we've put together a little video honoring women, mothers, and their influence before we get going. So just enjoy some of these testimonies.
It's my my mom was the most influential woman in my life. She loved Jesus. She was a prayer warrior. She was a worship leader. She was faithfully active in serving in the church. She encouraged me to be who I am. But most importantly, I saw as she lived her life, and she had influence, she had impact, and she left a legacy. And it was all with a kingdom focus. And that is what I want for my life.
Because
we have a love.
She loves us, and she gave us the baby dolls and the cheerleading pom-poms.
Yeah.
And that she loves us.
We love her!
Well, that would have to be my mom, and probably because of more of her difficulties than her ease of life. Mm-hmm. She had a lot of struggles all through her life, but it was her tenacity, her courage, her strength, her creativity.
I really think of my wife, Jackie, how she influenced me. We went on ended up on a blind date. She invited me back to her apartment, and I was all excited. And she sat on one side of the room, I sat on the other, and we talked about things about Jesus, which I had not ever really thought about before. And thanks to her and inviting me to church, I came to know the Lord.
For my mom, you know, I think there's two types of influence. I think there's where you demonstrate it's transformational in a way. You demonstrate a behavior and someone picks that up. And that's how my mom was for me. What I learned from her was, I think, my ability to give grace, maybe not often enough. Mm-hmm. Compassion, for sure. Love. That was what my mom was. My mom was my love, my hero, my protector. She was just the strongest influence of my life.
Well, that would be my wife, Shelley. She passed away about a year and a half ago. But there are a couple of character traits of hers that I really appreciate, especially now. One of them was that she was a fierce advocate for her kids. And if they were nervous about us having to talk to another parent in the neighborhood or something that happened at school, she would tell them that she's their best advocate. And although she would be as diplomatic as possible, the idea in her mind was represent our kids well, and so that they would know we had their back.
The most influential woman in my life was my mother, Joanne, for a multitude of reasons. Wasn't super close with my father growing up, and he was away quite a bit for work, and my mom was always my number one supporter. Whether it came to school or sports, she never missed a game. She always had my back. She taught me how to work hard, and she had an amazing sense of humor, and she loved all her children, and it set the foundation for who I am today as a father.
I started working for Miss Diana on this farm back in when I was 12, and she taught me a lot about working hard. And and when I was 14, she was in an equestrian accident, so I learned a lot about community because I watched them flow in here and build sidewalks and ramps to her barn so she could keep her farm even in a wheelchair. That was pretty awesome. And then in 98, I moved onto the farm to be her personal caretaker, and she taught me a lot about how it's okay. God wants us to need people in our lives, even if we're independent, because before her accident, she could do anything. And I mean, water pipes and equipment fixing, and did it all herself. And then now she's to the point where she needed everyone to help her, and she was just took it with grace. Anyway, God wants us to need people, and that's what she taught me.
Galatians 6 verse 2 calls us to be each other's burden bearers, and there are a few women that immediately come to my mind when I think about this verse. The first one is Kim Renner, and she taught me what it looks like to trust when trusting is hard. Julie Monroe Falk has taught me what it looks like to be a leader and to be a confident one. Ashley, my sister-in-law, has shown me and taught me what it looks like to love in the mess. And my best friend, Rachel, has shown me unconditional love and loyalty through all of the seasons.
And then there's women at church, women like Sandy Marble, Danielle Pagella, Joji Chapman, and Kaylin Call. Those women just love on our children immediately as they walk through the door. Never ever underestimate the power and the influence that you have over our children and us as mamas.
Amen. Yes. Influence. So God uses women to influence for his kingdom throughout history. Often when we read scripture, it's the women who are the giants of faith, the ones that God uses to do the miraculous in the stories. And today we are going to look at three of these women. We're going to learn from their influence. We're going to make application to our own life. We're going to celebrate the influence that they have, but also the women here have, because you have tremendous influence. And I'm here to say this world needs your influence. So we're going to look at three examples today. We are going to start off by looking at a woman named Deborah. Now, some of you might know these stories. Some of you might not. I have to summarize them very, very quickly. But I want us to see the influence that and the very specific ways that God used them. So Deborah, God used Deborah to inspire faith. Now, let me give you some context. Let me summarize this briefly. The story takes place during a time called the Judges. Now, some of you know what that means. Some of you don't. It's from the book of Judges. But Judges is a time frame in Israel's history. It's before there was a unified kingdom. It's before they had kings. They lived in tribal groups throughout the country of Israel. And often when they would fall away from God, stop following God, God would allow a neighboring kingdom to oppress them to get their attention. So they would turn back to God. And then God would raise up a judge to deliver them from that kingdom. This is what's taking place. There was a neighboring kingdom named Jabin, king of Hazor, it said. And they were ruthlessly oppressing Israel for 20 years. In fact, that's the word it used, ruthlessly. They were ruthless because there was a general in his army named Sisera. Sisera had not only an army, but he had 900 iron chariots. I mean, that's like having tanks, all right? He never lost a battle. For 20 years, he ruthlessly oppressed Israel. And then the Bible says, until Deborah. Deborah just shows up on the scene. And she is a woman of tremendous influence. We don't know how she got there. Someday it's going to be fun to talk to her in heaven. Deborah, what happened? Because a very male-oriented culture. Here's a woman where the people would go to her for counsel. They would go to her to hear from God. They would go to her. In fact, the Bible says she was a prophet. And she would give them instruction. She would settle disagreements. She would settle judgments. So her influence is phenomenal already. God speaks to her and says, it's time to throw off this oppression. I want you to get a hold of a man named Barak. And so she gets a hold of Barak. She says, God is going to give you victory over Sisera. Impossible. Impossible. This guy has never lost a battle. 900 chariots? We have none. She says, you get 10,000 men of Israel, you go fight the battle. Barak says, I'm not going unless you go with me. In that culture, a guy's asking a girl to go to battle with him. Never happens. That shows you how respected and how much influence that she has. Because, hey, Barak is just trying to save his own skin. So he's going, listen, I'll go to battle if you go with me. Deborah says, that's fine. But the victory of the battle will not be given to you. It will be given to a woman. And in Barak, again, I don't care. All right? So what happens is there's an epic battle. It does take place. The details of the battle is not important. What happens is Israel does win. Deborah inspires the faith of not only Barak, but the nation of Israel. And this is what I want you to see. That faith that inspired others, and the Bible describes it like this. Judges 5, 6, and 7. In the days of Shamgar, son of Anath, okay, you're thinking, who is that? Well, you have three judges. In the days of Jael, people avoided the main roads. Travelers stayed on winding paths. Horrible situation. There were few people left in the villages of Israel. See, they were afraid of Sisera, his army, his chariots. It says, until Deborah arose as a mother of Israel. What an amazing and a beautiful description. The Bible never says if Deborah had any children. She was married. We don't know if she had kids or not. Just doesn't say. But she's called the mother of Israel. That's quite a statement of influence. As we look at her influence, I want to take it away from the story, and I want us to ask some questions. Who are the people around you who are afraid? who are insecure, who are timid in their faith, paralyzed by some fear. Because I'm telling you, there are people around you everywhere like that today. How can your influence inspire faith like Deborah? How can you be a voice of faith to them to trust God? This is their moment to trust God, and yet they waver in that. How can you be that voice? How can you be a voice to have more and have more influence in their life than their fear? We all need people like that in our life. I think about my own story, my own faith journey. There was a woman that God used in my life decades ago, way before Foothills. I was a youth pastor. I was very young. I started being a youth pastor at 20. So I was like 20, maybe 24, 23, 24. I didn't have outside speaking engagements. I was rather insecure in my speaking ability because I didn't do it much except for my own students. Cheryl Robbins, this is who influenced me. She was a person who attended the same church, and she was a teacher at the local high school. And Cheryl also was in, she had a leadership class, and she put together a statewide leadership conference for students. She did it every year. And this particular year, she comes to this very young youth pastor, and she says, I want you to be there's a main speaker, and then they have breakout sessions. I want you to do a session. In fact, I want you to do three of them all afternoon, one group after another, on peer pressure. Because, you know, you already talk on peer pressure. You're a youth pastor. I want you to speak on peer pressure. I don't know what possessed me to say yes, okay? But I said yes. Scared out of my mind. I said, okay, well, how many kids are going to be in here? She says, it's no big deal. After the main session, they're going to rotate in 20, 30 kids. You do a 45-minute session. They leave. Next group comes in. Do it three times. Piece of cake. I said, okay. So I showed up on that day. Nervous, never done something like that before, all right? Listen, what you see today is not what I was all those years ago. I was scared. And to make matters worse, I'm there now, we're all set up, Cheryl is there looking at me going, you know, you got this, and then here come the kids. The kids start coming in, and they start coming in, and they start coming in. All of a sudden there's 30, then there's 40, then there's 50, then there's 60. Oh my gosh, they keep coming. And pretty soon, the room has well over 100 kids in it. Teachers, you know, people, their supervisors. I mean, there's people lining the room. I'm looking at her in panic, going, what did you do to me, okay? She kind of just keeps reassuring me, you got this, you got this, come on. And she's all excited. I'm petrified. She's smiling, all right? So I'm in the back of that room, and she's up there introducing me, and I'm scared out of my mind. And I prayed, Lord, please God help me in this moment. And I got to tell you, it was one of the first times where I experienced, and this may sound strange to some of you, I experienced something supernatural. Where I walked up on the platform, walked up in front of all those people, I spun around, and as soon as I had enough faith to walk up there, folks. That's about all the faith I had. I just asked the Lord to meet me there. And I walked up there, and I turned around. And as soon as I turned around, it was like I became somebody else. And I had never experienced that before. It was like God was there just waiting for me to trust him. I would have never had that experience or taken that step of faith without Cheryl. She inspired my faith. And Cheryl is now with the Lord. And I don't know how it all works in heaven, but if the Lord is up there, and of course he hears what I'm saying, if you could just tell Cheryl thank you for me, because she inspired my faith. She was a Deborah in my life. We all need a Deborah in our lives. Here's another example from God's word. There is a woman named Ruth. Now, God uses Ruth to provide hope, because Lord knows we need some hope in this world. And again, summarize the story. The story takes place at the same time period as the book of Judges. It's a separate book in the Bible called Ruth, but it takes place during the time of the Judges. The main character is this woman named Naomi. Her daughter-in-law is Ruth. I'll get to her in a second. Naomi is married. So she leaves Israel because of a famine and goes to the neighboring kingdom east of Israel named Moab, her and her husband and her two sons. They go to Moab. And they relocate there, something they were never supposed to do. While in Moab, her two sons married Moabite women, something else they weren't supposed to do. While they were there, tragedy strikes and Naomi's husband dies, and that's bad enough. And then pretty soon both her sons die. And now she's in a foreign land, she's poverty stricken, and she's with her two daughter-in-laws. She looks at her daughter-in-laws and says, listen, I have to go back to Israel. I have nothing. In fact, my life has become bitter. And so I want you to go back home. You go back to your people. Go back to your gods. Don't hang out with me anymore because it's a disaster hanging out with me. And so one of her daughter-in-laws leaves, but Ruth refuses to leave. And in verses 16 and 17, it says, but Ruth replied, don't ask me to leave you and turn back. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. Wherever you die, I will die. And there I will be buried. May the Lord punish me severely if I allow anything but death to separate us. I mean, Ruth's devotion to her mother-in-law is amazing. And some of you are going, my devotion isn't like that to my mother-in-law. Don't go there, all right? Let's talk about Ruth. She refuses to give up on the relationship. So she returns with Naomi to Israel with nothing. Completely poverty stricken. She arrives back. She actually renames herself. Don't call me Naomi. Call me Mara, which means bitter. Just call me bitter. Ugh. In order to survive, Ruth goes and gleans at a field. Back in those days, Israel was commanded to leave the edges of their grain fields, their crop, all the crops they grew, leave the edges for the poor people so they could go and glean. That's where the word gleaners comes from. It's a biblical term. And they would have food. So Ruth is there gleaning grain, and Boaz, who's the owner of the field, notices her. And it becomes a love story, all right? You'll have to read it, okay? And then what happens is Boaz marries Ruth. And then and because of that, he takes care of Naomi. And then Ruth has a child. And the child ends up being the grandfather of one of the greatest kings of Israel, King David. And she's included in the lineage of King David. At the end of the story, the Bible summarizes Ruth like this. In Ruth 4, then the women of the town said to Naomi, praise the Lord who has now provided a redeemer for your family. May this child be famous in Israel, was. May he restore your youth and care for you in your old age, for he is the son of your daughter-in-law. Now check this out. Who loves you and has been better to you than seven sons. The story just ends with incredible hope because of Ruth. Who are the people around you who are discouraged and losing hope? Who are the people in your life that you refuse to give up on? Everyone needs a person or two in their life like Ruth, folks. Some who believe in you no matter what. Because not everybody will, not everybody does. You already know that. But this is what Ruth was for Naomi. Just refused to give up on the relationship. For me, this voice in my life has always been my wife. My wife, Lisa, is a very Ruth-like person. She has very Ruth-like qualities to her. And Lord knows, I have been blessed by that over the years. She is someone who has believed in me no matter what. She has never wavered in her uncompromising belief in me. There was a season of my life before Foothills, a story that I won't go into, but before Foothills started, I was voted out of my last church. Painful, ugly, terrible story. I needed to pay bills. We had two little kids, and so I ended up washing windows professionally. So if you do need your glass cleaned, I do know how to do it, all right? But that was kind of a horrible season of life. My life fell apart. I was a pastor, and then in that season, I felt like I was nothing. And she was uncompromising in her belief in me, in her encouragement. Never a critical word. Never did she not believe in God's future. Never was there any wavering in the relationship. I would not have made it through that season without her. She never stopped believing that God had a future and a plan for my life. She was a source of hope during a very tough time. And let me just say that her influence on my life is still pretty incredible today. She is definitely a provider of hope, like Ruth. And I know for a fact that you have people in your life who need you to be that for them as well. That's Ruth. There's the next one, Esther. One more, Esther. So God uses Esther to embrace destiny or purpose. Now let me summarize this story. This takes place at a different time in the history of Israel when the Jewish people were scattered throughout the Persian Empire. Jerusalem had been destroyed decades earlier. Esther was chosen. She was a Jewish girl. She was chosen to be the new queen of the Persian king. During this time that she was queen, there was a plot that was discovered to exterminate the Jews. The only person who had enough influence to do anything about it was Esther. Her uncle, whose name was Mordecai, he sends Esther a message. And he asks her to embrace her destiny. And in Esther 4:14, it says this. This is Mordecai, her uncle. He says, if you keep quiet at a time like this, deliverance and relief for the Jews will arise from some other place, but you and your relatives will die. Who knows if perhaps you were made queen for just such a time as this? Well, she did embrace that and believe that God had put her there for this moment. She risks her life to uncover the plot to the king. The king agrees with her, and you see the story moves forward, and the Jewish people are saved. Now you might be thinking, how does that relate to me? How does God want you to embrace your destiny and being appointed for such a time as this? Men and women, destiny is simply embracing your part. It's embracing your role in God's narrative. It's accepting your unique contribution that only you can make. Only you can make it. Your influence is unique to your friends, to your spouse, to your kids, and your church. You've been placed in their lives for such a time as this. That's purpose. How can you be a voice to even somebody else to embrace their purpose that they've been put here for such a time as this? Now, for me personally, growing up, that voice has always been my mom, right? That voice has always been her. She laid a foundation in my life for destiny and purpose. And you say, well, why is that? There's my older brother and me. And growing up, there was lots of competition. That's normal between the two of us. My brother, there were certain things about him that he could do. He's simply better at me at certain things. To this day, he's simply better than I am at certain things. And back then, when I was junior high, first couple years in high school, again, those things bothered me. I think I wanted to be like him, or at least do what he could do. And my mom, bless her heart, the wisdom that sometimes God gives moms, okay? All 5'2" of her, she'd just pull me in, okay? She put her finger right here, and she says, God didn't make you to be a Jeff. That's my brother. God didn't make you to be a Jeff. God made you to be a Dale. You be Dale. You don't be Jeff. Man, I still hear it in my head, all right? Some of those messages we were supposed to hear in our head for the rest of our lives. Oh, praise God. Praise God for moms who believe that their kids have purpose and they have meaning, that they have destiny. That's who Esther was. So let's make some application. How will God use your life to influence others? Because he wants to use your life to influence. How has God called you to influence? God wants to use your life to influence the people around you. And I know you might be thinking, hey, listen, I'm no Deborah. I'm no Ruth. I'm no Esther. What can God do through me? I don't have even opportunities to influence. You have far more opportunities than you realize. And I want to finish by talking about the four opportunities that we all have every day. Every day around us. Like what? God will give you, first of all, generational opportunities. Men and women, we have young people around us all the time. Yes, the obvious application is for parents. Another application is to grandparents. But we are a multi-generational church. These kids up here, come on. These kids up here, they're watching you. Look, we have a lifestyle that we are called to live. Deuteronomy 11 says, teach them to your children, the word of God, the truths of the word of God. Teach them. to your children. Talk about them, God's truth. When you are at home, when you're on the road, when you're going to bed, when you're getting up, we must embrace our responsibility to influence the next generation intentionally. This responsibility is upon us whether or not we have children. Oh, I'm done with that. No, you're not. Of course, every parent needs to heed these words, but we all should. Generational opportunities are happening right now. They're happening before you walk out that door. They happen to us every day. You say, how? Children and students, they watch us. They watch us. I always say it's the parents. More is caught than taught. They're catching values. They're catching faith. These kids here, they see you out there. Well, they don't know me. Well, they don't know you, but they're watching. They're paying attention to you. They're seeing whether or not we're living out our faith. Let's inspire them. Let's have a faith that they cannot reason away. Whether you're here at church or they see you at Bi-Mart or Safeway or, well, they don't know who I am. They've seen you at church. It's enough. It's enough. God wants to use us to impact the next generation and be intentional about it. And those kids, they need to see Jesus in our life. Okay, I had 4 grandkids up here, okay? I'm a little biased, right? They were awesome today, all right? But I don't want to be, Lisa and I are committed to this, and their parents. But they need more than just us to inspire their faith. My grandkids need you. So does every kid up here. All right. Enough of that. We have generational opportunities. God will also give us opportunities related to our unique design because God just made you uniquely. This talks about spiritual gifts in 1 Corinthians 12. There are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit is the source of them all. Different kinds of service because we're different, but we serve the same Lord. God works in different ways, but it's the same God who does the work in all of us. God uses us in the way He created us. See, my mom knew that when she said, "You be Dale. You be who God made you to be." See, God's not asking you to be someone you're not. He already put everything you need inside of you. Just allow Him to use you, your gifts, your passion, your ability, your personality, everything that God created you with. Part of this for a moment, though, I want to shift over and talk to the women here. Part of this design is your gender. Now more than ever, we need women to embrace and celebrate their gender. I'm not saying this to be political at all. I want to be biblical, all right? And I want you to understand something. You represent the image of God. You, ladies, you represent the image of God. We cannot understand the image of God without you and your feminine qualities, okay? God is more than just masculine. It's feminine qualities. That's why the Bible says that He made men and women in the image of God. Men and women in the image of God. He created them, male and female. He created them. This insanity that is going on with gender, okay? I'm telling you, it is spiritual. The enemy wants to distort the image of God. And how he distorts the image of God is by distorting the gender that he created us with. Ladies, we need you right now. Be who God made you to be. And that is a feminine quality because that is the image of God. Someone say amen. Okay, there we go. Yeah. I love that Deborah, go back to the story, she's called the mother of Israel. They didn't redefine Deborah calling her the warrior of Israel. It was her feminine qualities that saved Israel. Her faith through her feminine qualities. It was the mother of Israel that inspired faith to trust God. Be who God made you to be. We're celebrating that today. All right, here's the next one. God will give us opportunities using our experiences. 2 Corinthians 1:4, He covers us in our troubles so that we can comfort others. He doesn't waste it. He doesn't waste the pain. When they are troubled, we will be able to give them the same comfort God has given us. Notice how our experiences, and again, it's often the painful ones that help others the most. So do yours. You have a unique life experience that can encourage and inspire and connect and breathe life into other people. Allow God to use that. But let me give you one word of caution. Okay, one word of caution in this. Our life experiences should not turn us into advice givers. Our life experiences should turn us into heart connectors. Our painful experiences should help us have more compassion and understanding for others. And then when we love people like that, that's when God gives us influence. Notice in 2 Corinthians that we give others comfort. We give them comfort, not advice. Often people need to know we understand, we relate, we get it, we care first. If someone is pouring out their pain and their frustration and their despair, please do not let the first thing out of your mouth be, well, you know what you need to do is. What does it feel like to be on the receiving end of that? Do you want God to use your experiences to influence? Okay, here you go. Heart first, head second. If you will connect heart to heart with them, giving them the comfort that God gave you, people will ask you for input. Heart first, head second. All right, last one. God will give us opportunities in our existing networks of relationships. You don't have to go looking for influence. You already have them. You already have people in your life. How are you influencing the people around you? Regardless whether or not you're intentional, you're still influencing. So we might as well be intentional with it. Stop and ask yourself, what type of impact am I having on the people around me? My spouse, my kids, my grandkids, my coworkers, my friendships, even the random stranger. The person at the grocery store, the person pumping your gas. It's like this whole world, we treat people like things instead of human beings created in the image of God. There are people all around you every day, that desperately need hope. They need encouragement. I mean, good grief. So they just need a good word from someone. A smiling face, a thank you, a compliment. A reason to keep going and stay in the game, stay in the fight. Go be that person. Go be that person. I'm so thankful for all the people over the years who have played this type of role in my life. Who knows where I would be today if they did not embrace opportunity to influence. Today, I just want to finish by saying thank you. I want to thank all the women here for the influence that you already have and the influence that God is going to continue to entrust to you. Thank you for that role. Thank you for who you are, made in the image of God. And Lord knows where I would be without the influence of so many women in my life. So, for all of us, I guarantee you there are people in your life right now, they need you to inspire faith. There's people wavering in their faith, wavering if they should trust God or not. And God has put you in their life. So regardless of your gender, go be a Deborah, right? Go inspire someone like Deborah. There are people in your life, they wonder if anybody cares. Maybe they even wonder if you're going to abandon them. And maybe they need you to go up to them and say, I'm in this. I'm in this relationship, no matter what. Be a Ruth. Be someone who just refuses to walk away. I realize you can't do that with every relationship, but I guarantee you there's somebody who needs that from you. And there's somebody else who just, they believe they have no point and they have no purpose. And you can influence them and say, God made you. Go be you. Go be the person that God made you to be. We all can influence like that. And I believe that's what God is asking us to be and do. And on this Mother's Day, let's go do that. Let's go inspire people. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I want to thank you so much that you've given us examples. Examples in your word, like Deborah, Ruth, Esther. Women of faith, women of character, women who changed the course of people's lives and even a nation. I think sometimes it's easy for us to look in the mirror and say, what can God do in and through me? And God, I just ask that you would unleash the influence of people here. They have far more influence than they understand. I want to thank you for the women that are here, the mothers that are here. And Lord, I just pray that you would encourage them today. I ask that you would bless them today. I ask that you would breathe life in them today. Whether it's a hard day for some, it's a great day for others, but would you meet everyone right where they're at today and let them know you love them. And may they feel your favor on their lives today. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We love you. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Lord bless you. Happy Mother's Day.
Such a blessing to be with all these lovely women. And for those of you on live stream, I hope today blessed you as well. We are called to be a light, so let's shine brightly together.